Goedemorgen, bonjour, good morning. Ik ga verder in het Nederlands om u welkom te heten op dit eerste Policy Lab van EUKN met België sinds een tijdje. We zijn zeer verheugd om met de POD Maatschappelijke Integratie opnieuw samen te werken en een Policy Lab te organiseren over een onderwerp dat de laatste tijd alleen maar belangrijker is geworden, namelijk dak- en thuisloosheid. Een probleem dat door de COVID-pandemie alleen maar groter is geworden en ook een probleem dat een heel duidelijke stedelijke dimensie heeft. Over deze onderwerpen, over de wijze waarop we dak- en thuisloosheid tegen kunnen gaan, preventie kunnen maatregelen kunnen nemen en de problematiek van dak- en thuisloosheid kunnen aanpakken, gaat dit policy zijn. We hebben een erg vol programma van 3 uur, tussen 9 en 12 uur. Maar eerst, laat me eerst eventjes, voordat ik daar het woord over geef aan onze gastheer en vrouw, een paar toelichtingen geven. Dit is een policy lab dat in 3 talen zal plaatsvinden. En de deelnemers kunnen hun eigen taal kiezen. Kies het blokje interpretation, vertaling, interpretation, om uw taal naar keuze te kiezen. Engels, Nederlands of Duits. Iedereen kan in zijn eigen taal of in een van deze 3 talen deelnemen aan de discussies. Vragen stellen in de Q&A die we zullen oppakken. Deze sessie wordt opgenomen, maar dat is puur voor interne doelen. Voor de rapportering die we zullen gaan uitvoeren. En na een aantal algemene presentaties zullen we in 3 verschillende werkgroepen verder gaan. Die zullen we zo meteen toelichten. Je krijgt uitgebreid in de chat ook aanwijzingen over de wijze waarop u kunt deelnemen aan die verschillende deelsessies. Maar laat mij nu eerst, want ik had maar heel weinig tijd voor deze korte inleiding, het woord geven aan Alexandre Lesif, president du PPSS SI, notre partenaire primordial de la part de la Belgique. Avant, pour introduire la thématique d'aujourd'hui. Alexandre, je vous donne la parole.
Merci Martine et mesdames les ministres, chers participants, c'est pour moi un grand plaisir de vous accueillir aujourd'hui à ce Policy Lab en ligne sur la thématique du sans-abrisme. Alors, les nouvelles mesures sanitaires nous forcent malheureusement à l'organiser de manière virtuelle. Nous avions espérer jusqu'au dernier moment pouvoir au moins l'organiser sous une forme hybride et vous offrir la possibilité à ceux qui le souhaitaient d'être présents à Bruxelles, mais l'évolution de la situation sanitaire ne nous le permettait vraiment pas. Alors, je dirais, mais qu'importe, parce que je vois que vous êtes quand même très nombreux aujourd'hui, près de 200, à vous connecter de chez vous, en Belgique ou même à l'étranger, et ça témoigne évidemment de l'intérêt de cette problématique urbaine. Alors, le SPP Intégration sociale, mon administration, a dans ses compétences la lutte contre la pauvreté. Et nous avons développé au cours des années une expertise en la matière par la rédaction de propositions, la participation à différents groupes de travail et l'élaboration d'une politique fédérale dans ce domaine. Certains de nos experts vont d'ailleurs et font partie de la plateforme européenne de lutte contre le sans-abrisme et qui vient de voir le jour et dont la ministre Karine Lallieu vous parlera tout à l'heure. D'autres de nos experts forment la cellule d'appui fédérale des équipes Housing First qui est en place dans plusieurs villes belges et qui participe aux formations et aux échanges d'expériences organisés par le réseau européen de Housing First. Alors, vous les rencontrerez plus tard dans la matinée si vous avez opté pour les ateliers consacrés à cette problématique. Ce Policy Lab, et j'en suis heureux, est co-organisé avec le réseau EUKN. Et nous sommes très heureux d'avoir pu réintégrer cette année ce réseau d'échange entre les États et d'y représenter la Belgique. Cela va nous permettre de participer au débat européen sur les questions urbaines. Je remercie donc ici tout particulièrement son directeur, Martine Griessel, ainsi que ses collaboratrices, Léa Scherer et Livia Del Corte, pour leur précieuse et agréable collaboration dans l'organisation de cette matinée d'information. Alors, en ce qui concerne le programme de cette matinée, je vais tout à l'heure donner la parole à Myriam Kittir, la ministre de la Coopération au Développement et qui est également en charge de la politique des grandes villes et qui vous donnera un mot d'introduction. Elle sera suivie par une vidéo de Karine Lalieu qui espérait pouvoir être également présente mais qui malheureusement a dû enregistrer son intervention. Karine Lalieu qui est ministre de l'intégration sociale et de la lutte contre la pauvreté. Après ces introductions, ce sera le tour de Surtje van Heerde du John Research Center de la Commission européenne qui nous dressera un état des lieux du sans-abrisme en Europe. Ensuite, comme Martine vous l'a dit tout à l'heure, vers 10h30, on va être scindé en différents ateliers. Vous aurez la possibilité de choisir votre atelier. Vous recevrez toutes les instructions pour pouvoir aller dans votre atelier. On reviendra alors vers 11h45 pour la clôture de la matinée et ce sera donc Martine Griessels qui clôturera les travaux de cette matinée. Je ne serai pas plus long, je vous souhaite à toutes et à tous des échanges riches, fructueux sur une thématique qui est importante à la fois dans la lutte contre la pauvreté et dans les politiques urbaines. Je cède donc la parole à Madame la ministre Myriam Kittir, qui est ministre des Grandes Villes. Myriam, la parole est à toi.
Merci, Alexander. I'm sorry, I'm still in the car, so I will do my intervention from the car on my way to Brussels. So, dear friends and colleagues, for the first time in my life, I am really proud of myself. That is what a barely 17-year-old girl from Antwerp told me recently after she explained how it felt to live on the edge of the society. And finally, had she found perspective, finally the future was looking a bit brighter. I was inspired by her strength, as she carried a heavy backpack. Indeed, for a while, homeless lurked around the corner. But now, thanks to a roof over her head and personalized support, she is stepping back into society. Her self-confidence has been boosted. Social inequality has been intensified by the pandemic. And in our cities, that social inequality is more visible than elsewhere. Homeless is on the rise. In the rest of Europe, too, numbers are peaking. Behind every number, there is always a person. And someone who carries a unique backpack and needs an adapted way out of her or his crisis. And that is precisely why I believe in the housing first principle. Not only is a roof over one's head provided, but also, and this is just as important, supervising and intensifying guidance toward training, a job, or simply getting acquainted with administrative matters, always tailor-made. A few weeks ago, I had the opportunity to visit a similar project in Glasgow, and also there people were able to fall back on Housing First's support. Their perseverance touched me deeply. Being homeless cannot be underestimated. Having to find ways of surviving every day, not being able to fall back on anyone, and having to stand up over and over again. But now I know that if I need care, I will come. That is what one of the people in the Glasgow told me. Both in Antwerp and Glasgow, I hear that beside of a roof over their heads, people also found the necessary rest. Only for those peaceful at mind is stepping back into society an option. So dear friends, we from our side need to step up our efforts. Exceptional times require exceptional measures. So for me and my colleague, the Minister of Poverty, Karine Lalieu, Housing First programs are at the top of our priority list. Given the high number of young people becoming homeless, this is where we will focus our efforts first. And indeed, the numbers of people living under the age of 25 has increased by 10% in Belgium. Young people between 18 and 25 represent almost 20% of the total group of homeless people. And this is an inconvenient truth. We cannot ignore these alarm bells. This is a battle we must fight together so that young people can take charge of their own future. Housing First is a valuable approach to this. And I'm sure that there are also other approaches that achieve equal strong results and from which we can learn. And that is why this exchange of today is so important. We have to look beyond our own approaches and get inspired by what is happening elsewhere to establish a dialogue between Marseille and Charleroi, between Utrecht and Antwerp, and between Edinburgh and Kortrijk. I would like to end with a special word of thanks to all the staff of the European Urban Knowledge Network and our administration who helped make this webinar possible. This was not an easy enterprise in these difficult COVID-19 times, so I wish you a very interesting exchange and I'm looking forward to hearing your insights and experience. Thank you for listening.
Hartelijk dank, mevrouw Kitier. Het is geweldig dat u de tijd heeft genomen om ons in een drukke dag als de uwe toe te spreken. Helemaal eens dat deze problematiek meer aandacht verdient. U noemt de getallen in België. Ik heb nog eens even ook gekeken hoe dat in Nederland ligt. Dramatische toename inderdaad van dak- en thuislozen, ook in Nederland. Een rijk land, net als België. Waar de problematiek enorm is toegenomen, vooral ook onder jongeren. Een van de onderwerpen waar we het over gaan hebben, met ook Housing First en andere vormen van huisvesting, collectieve huisvesting. Dat zijn de drie thema's van onze breakout sessions. We komen daar zo meteen nog op terug. Ik gaf al aan dat dak- en thuislozen is een complex probleem, een wicked problem zou je dat kunnen zeggen met ingewikkelde woorden. En dat betekent ook dat het een kwestie is waar meerdere ministeries bij betrokken zijn en ook meerdere ministers. Daarom ben ik ook blij om een collega van u te kunnen aankondigen. Karine Lalieu, die verantwoordelijk is voor sociale maatschappelijke integratie en de strijd tegen armoede. Dit is niet alleen maar een probleem van grote steden, het is een veel algemener probleem. Je suis donc très heureux de pouvoir annoncer maintenant la presse par vidéo de Madame la ministre Karine Lalieu et on peut lancer la vidéo maintenant.
Madame la ministre, chère Myriam, chers collègues, Monsieur le Président, cher Alexandre, chers partenaires du réseau EUKN, chers participants en Belgique et ailleurs en Europe. Heureuse de m'adresser à vous tous à l'occasion de ce Policy Lab portant sur la prévention et l'éradication sans abri. Ce qui me tient particulièrement à cœur. J'avais prévu de me joindre à vous, mais les circonstances m'ont décidé. À l'initiative de la Fondation Roi Baudouin et avec le soutien des autorités publiques locales et des associations, des dénombrements de personnes sans abri ont été réalisés dans différentes villes. On peut parler sans détour d'une augmentation du nombre de personnes sans abri, ainsi que d'une diversité. et des personnes de différentes origines. Les éléments et plus globalement l'évolution du sans-abrisme en Europe seront certainement abordés par Madame du John Fisher. Je la remercie par avance pour son intervention. Le travail des scientifiques, la collecte des données et leur analyse sont fondamentales. Elles permettent au pouvoir public de développer les politiques les plus adaptées possibles. Les connaissances consolidées doivent nourrir notre réflexion et notre entre autres de cette manière que le Housing First a commencé à s'imposer comme solution au sans-abrisme chronique. Ainsi, avec le soutien des services d'intégration sociale, des services publics fédéraux et des acteurs clés de la société civile, travaillons à la mise en œuvre d'un plan fédéral de lutte contre la pauvreté qui vise à la multiplication des trajets d'accompagnement en sans attendre l'application de ce plan et avec l'aide de la Loterie nationale, j'ai déjà augmenté les crédits pour le trajet Housing First. 19 projets répartis sur l'ensemble de la Belgique ont été choisis pour accompagner plus de 180 personnes dans leur chemin de sortie de la rue et vers une nouvelle existence. C'est le premier wagon d'un train de mesure. Convaincu que nous avons le devoir de créer une dynamique systémique. Nous devons créer les conditions de changement de perspective pour la prise en charge des personnes passées de l'urgence aux conditions structurelles. Dans le même ordre d'idée, seule une action concertée et une approche globale de la pauvreté nous permettront d'atteindre des objectifs. C'est pourquoi je travaillerai en bonne collaboration avec les fédéraux et ceux des différents niveaux de pouvoir compétents. Et je me félicite d'ailleurs de notre collaboration avec Mme la ministre Kittner, en charge de la politique des grandes villes. Je la remercie d'avoir lancé l'initiative de Sun voilà, ici Lab et de m'y avoir associé avec ma collègue ministre. Nous souhaitons lancer la première conférence interministérielle sur le thème du sans-abrisme. Au cours de celle-ci, nous souhaitons mettre en place des collaborations solides avec les autorités régionales. Succès politique dépend d'une approche intégrée entre l'ensemble des niveaux de pouvoir. Le succès de nos politiques aussi être remporté par une dynamique européenne positive. Nous, la Belgique, j'ai assisté le 21 juin dernier à la conférence de Lisbonne, organisée par la présidence portugaise, lors de laquelle j'ai signé la déclaration invitant les États membres à ensemble les efforts de la plateforme européenne de lutte contre le sans-abri et d'œuvrer à l'élimination du sans-abri d'ici. Comme le dit M. Yves Le Cair, président du comité directeur de la plateforme, la lutte contre le sans-abrisme ne peut être gagnée. Travaillons ensemble, local, gouvernement régional et européen. L'implication des organisations de la société civile, de l'économie sociale et des personnes ayant une expérience du sans-abrisme est également de la plus haute importance. Nous devons travailler avec la approche intégrée, la prévention, au logement et l'accueillement. Je vous souhaite une matinée.
Deelnemers, een videoconferentie zonder technische problemen bestaat niet, geloof ik. En ik moet constateren dat de videostreaming deze keer niet goed verloopt. We gaan de video nog een keertje afspelen aan het einde van onze webinar. Op dit moment is dat tekort. Excuses aan minister Lalieu, die er zelf niet bij is, maar we gaan hem nog een keer afspelen. Ik zag ook een vraag in de chat of alle presentaties, en dat geldt ook voor de video, achteraf nog beschikbaar worden gesteld. Dat gaan we zeker doen. Excuses voor deze technische storing, inderdaad. We gaan hem nog een keer afspelen aan het einde van het programma. Maar laten we nu inderdaad doorgaan met het programma zoals oorspronkelijk gepland. Tenzij ik een berichtje doorkrijg dat we het nu direct kunnen doorspelen. Ik geloof dat dat niet het geval is. We gaan even kijken hoe we het kunnen oplossen, want we zijn nog wat ruim in de tijd. Maar we zitten hier ook met inderdaad, zoals al werd gezegd, met een wat ingewikkelde technische organisatie waarin mensen op verschillende plekken zitten. We gaan nu door en ik wil graag aankondigen onze keynote speaker, Sjoerdje van Heerden. Sjoerdje werkt voor het Joint Research Center, een onderdeel van de Europese Commissie die zich vooral bezighoudt met onderzoek ter ondersteuning van beleid. En het Joint Research Center heeft onlangs een studie gedaan naar de thematiek van vandaag, dak- en thuislozen. Een hardnekkig onderwerp waar ook veel onderzoeksvragen over bestaan. En ik ben heel blij dat het Joint Research Center met alle onderzoekscapaciteit die het heeft, hier nu onderzoek naar gedaan heeft. Want zoals wel vaker bij Europees onderzoek is de hele kwestie van data. Waar hebben we het nou precies over? Hoe zit die problematiek nou echt in elkaar? En hoe kunnen we, zoals ook minister Lalieu heeft aangekondigd, in Europees verband deze problematiek aanpakken? Dat zijn allemaal grote vragen. En ik ben heel blij dat Sjoerdje van Heerden ons daar wat meer over kan gaan vertellen. Ik wil nogmaals ook de deelnemers uitnodigen om vragen te stellen in de Q&A. Want na de presentatie van Sjoerdje is er ook mogelijkheid voor vragen. En ik zie dat minister Kitia nog steeds bij ons is. Dus we kunnen misschien dat zo meteen combineren na afloop van de keynote. Sjoerdje, het is een groot genoegen je te kunnen aankondigen. Ik heb begrepen dat je in het Engels spreekt, in ieder geval een presentatie hebt in het Engels en ook de presentatie in het Engels doet. Klopt dat?
Yes, thank you, Mark. All right. I will do my presentation in English. I will share my screen and my slides. I'm disabled from sharing. Can you still see it?
Yeah, we can see everything. Perfect. Go ahead.
But I cannot, I'm very sorry, but I cannot skip a slide.
Just say next slide and we'll help you.
Ah, you have my presentation. I'm not sharing the screen. I understand. Okay. So thank you, Mart. Thank you very much for the invitation to speak. Also, thank you everyone, of course, who is participating this morning, especially also the Belgian Federal Public Planning Service for Social Integration. And you can as well. It's always a pleasure to work with you. And also now feeling even more motivated and inspired by the words we heard from the ministers just now, I would like to steal some time from you to tell you a bit more about homelessness in EU cities and towns from the EU perspective, and more specific about the study we indeed have just conducted and that it's actually still ongoing. Maybe first, let me quickly introduce myself. My name is Sjoerdje van Heerden. As you might know from my accent or from my name, I'm Dutch, but actually I'm based in Spain where I work for the Joint Research Center of the European Commission. Next slide, please. Yes, so what is the Joint Research Center exactly? We are the European Commission, but we do fulfill some kind of special role within the Commission because we are the in-house knowledge and support service. So we are definitely policy neutral and we try to provide evidence-based support for all kinds of EU policies. We publish around 1400 scientific publications per year on this wide range of EU policies. And due to the fact that we have this academic background, it's unsurprising that also a high share of our core staff has a PhD. So this is about 83% of us has this scientific background. And we do perform provide support for a wide range of EU policies, as I said, but also specifically for the EU, the urban dimension of the EU policies. So think, for instance, of empirical evidence-based support for all the partnerships for the urban agenda of for the EU, but also for the local implementation of the sustainable, the more globally envisioned sustainable development goals. Next slide, please. Yes, so before I continue, just let me quickly tell you what is the structure of what I would like to tell you today. So first, I will quickly tell you some EU state of play, what's going on with homelessness in the EU. Then I will dive into the study we have recently conducted and also point you towards some other work of JRC that is related to homelessness. And I will conclude with some EC and EU policies and initiatives that are currently in place in order or that are related to the fight against homelessness. So next slide, please. Yes, next slide, please. So when we dive into the EU state of play, we already notice immediately that we have one big challenge that is at the basis of everything, and this is actually methodological. So many factors are in play, of course, but when we want to say something about homelessness in EU cities and towns, we already have this basic issue of different definitions that are being used. So what exactly is homelessness? Before we can obtain any numbers, we have to have an agreement about that, and also how do we collect the data in order to provide these numbers. So we see many cities actually use and institutions use different definitions, but FEANSA, as you are aware of, I think, I'm quite certain, did propose already a typology for statistical purposes and also to obtain harmonized data, which is the ETHOS definition, or also referred to as ESOS Lite, which breaks it down into six categories of homeless people or who can be considered homeless or in precarious living conditions. So first of all, maybe what everyone thinks right away when you think of homelessness are the people living rough. So actually the people who are living on the streets, but then also people living in the emergency accommodation, so those in the overnight shelters, just accommodation for the homelessness, so the temporary shelters, the women's shelters, refugee shelters, but also think of institutions, for instance, health institutions, youth care institutions, prisons, and we have also non-conventional dwellings such as mobile homes or temporary structures, and people who are... Yes.
Sorry, I need to interrupt you. I'm really sorry about that. Apparently, the French translation channel is not functioning at the moment. So let's wait for a few seconds. And in the meantime, perhaps, if I may say so, you're introducing this issue of this definition of data, right?
Yes.
In preparing for this meeting, I noticed that there's a big debate about what exactly we are talking about. This ETHOS definition, is it used by all member states in the official statistics that the different countries use?
Okay, no, indeed, it's a very important issue that lies to me, especially as a scientist, at the base of all the debate about homelessness. And I would say across the board in member states, the bigger cities, the bigger institutions, they all rely on the ETHOS definition. But what I will also tell you a little bit later in the presentation is that it's not, especially when you go to the smaller urban areas, this definition is not picked up. And actually, we still see that although the definition is there, it also requires a lot of different data collection methods. So it's quite intensive. It's quite work intensive to even try to collect data according to this definition.
Cela requiert beaucoup de travail.
Many, if not most, institutions,
et
members,
la plupart
states,
des institutions et des États membres, des bureaux de statistiques connaissent très bien cette définition ETHOS. Seulement, en pratique, les data devraient être de meilleure qualité. Et entre-temps, donc, vous entendez la traduction vers le français. Merci pour... cette première partie de votre présentation. Donc, nous vous écoutons pour la suite.
Yes, if we can go back. Okay, welcome also to all the people relying on the French channel. I'm sorry you were not able to follow me translated before, but I warmly welcome you now. As I was explaining, we first of all face these methodological challenges when we try to say something about the EU state of play of homelessness. And we strive for a better harmonized approach in this respect because we need it for statistical purposes.
Nous avons besoin
despite these challenges, we do have a general notion or idea what's going on in Europe. So next slide, please.
Alors, j'aimerais passer à la diapo suivante.
For this, we can actually also rely on other figures and numbers, but also on homelessness itself.
Sur
but first of all,
chiffres.
Forced homelessness and housing are very much interlinked. And here you see a graph that's based on Eurostat data that shows the share of households in every member state, still including the UK, by the way, that spend
dans tous
more
les États
than 60% of their disposable household income on housing. So,
en logement.
In 60%
donc voici le graphique en 2019 de la quantité de ménages qui doivent dépenser plus de 60% de leurs revenus uniquement pour avoir un logement. Vous voyez qu'en Grèce, ce taux est supérieur à 65%, c'est-à-dire que deux tiers des ménages dépensent ce montant. Et la moyenne dans l'Union européenne est toujours de 20%, ce qui est quand même
considérable. And we have around 225 million households in the EU.
Il y a à peu près
and also 10% of those are overburdened by housing costs. And now I do not refer to the 60%
Europe,
at least,
ou dans
because this is extremely overburdened, but this is regular overburdened, which is not a nice place to be in as well, which is more than 40% of the disposable income goes to housing costs. And also to shine some more light on this, it's almost 70% of the households live in overcrowded conditions, so almost
70%
of the households
live
in
des conditions de,
and 7% have difficulty in maintaining
trop de personnes
an adequate temperature
dans
in their accommodation. Clearly this refers to the issue of energy
quantité de ménages qui ont même,
29
du mal à
million
chauffer,
of the households they actually
leur
also
logement.
Live in damp conditions. So while this does not refer to homelessness
même
directly,
si cela
it just
n'a peut-être pas de lien immédiat avec le sans-abrisme, cela démontre clairement que de nombreuses personnes sont à risque et qu'il y a également un phénomène d'exclusion dans le domaine du logement. Chaque soir, à peu près 700 000 personnes passe la nuit
next
dehors
slide,
ou dans un centre d'accueil.
And then when we look at the EU in general, we see that
dans l'Union européenne,
the image is not so optimistic because
au total,
in general,
nous voyons
for the
une image
past
qui
years,
n'est
we
pas
have
très
been
rose.
Upwards. I have to say there's also
la
some countries
dans
that
la dernière
are stabilizing.
Année, malheureusement,
in Denmark, we also see some stabilizing
vers la hausse.
Trends, but
même
usually
si
this
nous
is
voyons
a very
quelques
high levels
tendances
of homelessness
de stabilisation,
to begin with.
Notamment au Danemark.
And
on part déjà d'un niveau trop élevé, bien sûr.
Increasing, and we only see Finland as an exception where it's decreasing. So just let me name three of the examples that are also pointed out on the sheet. For instance, in the
positive.
Netherlands, we saw in one year a 50%
par exemple,
increase in youth homelessness, and in Lithuania, we saw in the past 8 years more than 32% increase of the presence of mothers and their children in shelters, and in Denmark, we saw young homelessness, despite these trends leveling off, but young homelessness were actually increased a lot in the past 6 years, up
même
to 85%. So as was mentioned before, already
donc,
we have
these
profiles that are changing when we see more young people being homeless.
Nous voyons donc
next
de plus
slide,
en plus de
please.
Jeunes qui n'ont plus de domicile,
so,
qui n'ont plus
the
de
EU
toit.
Clearly has some main challenges it has to
il est donc clair
and
que l'Union européenne
that.
Doit relever
so,
des défis majeurs. Les niveaux de sans-abrisme ont augmenté dans la plupart des États membres dans la dernière décennie. Et la crise financière n'aide pas non plus, bien sûr. Le profil de la population
more children,
sans toit
migrants, Roma,
inclut
and other disadvantages,
plus de
minorities,
jeunes, women and families are increasingly at risk of homelessness.
And we do have this issue of a lack of comprehensive data, which would allow us actually for monitoring, especially over time of homelessness in the EU.
Et nous ne disposons pas de suffisamment de données pour pouvoir monitorer le phénomène dans l'Union européenne. Bien sûr, ce n'est pas agréable de vivre dans la rue, mais en plus de cela, il y a un coût social très élevé.
So I came here to the part where I would like to tell you a bit more about our study that we have recently conducted. So just some basic understandings about our study. We have conducted this in spring summer this year, so it's very recent. I'm also showing you now preliminary data, the first results. We have not completed the entire analysis yet, but this is like the first time we will present our results, what we have analyzed so far.
Surveys
actually supported by FEAN, so we got support from FEAN side, also by Eurocities in terms of drafting the survey, in terms of content, but also for distributing it amongst the European cities and towns.
Et
the reason that we
get
the survey also right
tous ceux
now
qui ont collaboré
is because
à ce
we hope that
distribué.
The data that countries and cities have about homelessness actually improved due to the pandemic because there was more administrative registration of homeless people
la pandémie, il y a eu moins de données et moins d'enregistrements de personnes sans-abri qui se sont adressées à différents centres. Donc, il est devenu encore plus difficile de cartographier le phénomène.
To have a variety in the urban classification.
Nous avons
in terms of
inclus
population.
Dans notre projet
de grandes villes,
mais également de petites villes.
I present to you the first results, and we expect the full
voici les premiers résultats.
To be released early next year.
Nous
next
espérons
slide,
que au début de l'année
now,
prochaine, nous pourrons publier le rapport complet.
The definitions and the data sources that were used according to the cities or that are being used to track homelessness, it completely reflects what I mentioned in the beginning, because we see that a whopping 87% of them, of the cities that reply, define homelessness as a variation of the idea of someone without a fixed residence, but not going into much detail and also completely leaving out the nuance brought by the ethos light typology. So it's 87% does not adhere to a very all-encompassing definition. 4% of the cities do not use a formal or official definition at all, and 9% of the cities do use the ethos typology. And as I just also spoke with Mart about earlier, this is usually those are the larger institutions and cities that are more familiar with the work already. And for as far as the data collection methods, it is shown that most of the cities actually rely on service use, so service organizations that tell the city how much shelter use, the numbers of shelter use, and also public institutions. So they're actually their own administrative data. Many informed that they also use police data or unemployment data. These kind of city data in order to get a better grasp of the homelessness figure. What was quite surprising to us is that not a lot of cities make use of the more traditional count method, where there's a, well, you could maybe say some sort of physical inventory where people actually go on the street and count the homeless people they encounter. Next slide, please. So as I said, we try to include a wide variety of typology of urban classification, so ranging from really large metropolitan areas to smaller towns that include, I see it says 10,000 inhabitants, but we even go smaller below 5,000 inhabitants. And the total population covered by our survey is around or almost 37 million people. And from this 37 million people, there is a total of homelessness persons that has been observed around 41,000 people, a bit more. So this actually breaks down to around 0.13% of the population we we studied is homelessness. Also, keep in mind, this is according to the definitions they have been using. This makes around 1 in 1,000 people, but it differs greatly between the cities. So the values range between zero homelessness actually or 0.95, which equals almost 1 in 100 person is homelessness in that specific city or municipality. And overall, we see this moderate positive linear relationship between population and homelessness, which means the more population, the higher the population number in a specific city, the higher the share of homelessness in that city as well. And when we look at zero homelessness, because also luckily some of the cities replied that that year they experienced zero homelessness, we see that the larger urban agglomerations, they completely disappear from the picture, but that it's mostly is for the cities that have less than 5,000 or less than 10,000 inhabitants. For instance, cities with less or around 5,000 inhabitants, almost 50% of them indicated they have no homelessness currently. And as you see, this goes, this decreases to around 5% for the smaller urban areas. Next slide, please. And then asking the cities for the primary causes for homelessness as they see it in their cities. First of all, this really was highly on top of the most mentioned causes, mental problems and or addiction. Second, loss in or of income. And third, family circumstances such as divorce. Although we got this top three, I'm sure everybody also understands that these causes can be much interlinked together. Next slide, please. And also asking the cities about their main lessons learned with regards to tackling and fighting homelessness before the pandemic, we got some interesting results as well, because many of them stressed that they really need to take into account when they're fighting homelessness, and this should also be strengthened and improved, the diversity of the group, because we see the profiles are actually more diversifying, and this has to be taken into account in terms of policy for gender, age, ethnicity, and background. Then it's also important to hold the private sector to account by regulated rents and binding conditions when public funding is addressed. And it requires an integrated intervention and monitoring model. So with many sectoral policies also taken into account, and building a coalition between all partners involved. What was also very often mentioned is that it really needs a person-oriented approach. And I think this also relates back to the three main causes I just mentioned before, where they see that many cities prefer a case manager model, where there's really one person that follows the specific case of the homeless person and knows all the personal issues that are in place for that person. And we need the homeless person to be involved as well in their own change process. So it's also a way of finding out how can we also make sure that the homeless person keeps on being invested also in this change process that will likely improve their living conditions. And most cities actually did not refer to the definition or to the methods of data collection, but stated that the main difficulty in obtaining data is actually not first obtaining it, but then updating it. Next slide, please. And I showed you before that that Europe is in overall trending upwards, but we also asked all the cities itself about the trend in homelessness numbers the 10 years before the pandemic started. And so what we see is that actually a large number still says indeed they see a positive trend, which actually means an increase in homelessness. And the most often reasons for this that were mentioned are higher poverty incidence, less affordable housing, and a change in administration. So a change in government, which I think also refers to a change maybe in funding or a change in policy priorities. And those who experience an increase also again highlighted that there is in general more youth, more women, more refugees are seen at the services, But notwithstanding, still on average, homeless population mostly consists of men. So on average, more than 80% is men. And also most of them are still, regarding these cities we have surveyed, are still nationals. More than 70%, almost 75% are nationals. And then for the cities that actually observed a decrease in homelessness, they mentioned a change in policy, more affordable housing, lower poverty incidence, and clearly this also relates to the housing-led and housing-first approaches, and a change in funding, which I would assume would mean a change in funding, as in more funding. Next slide, please. So I mentioned already the housing first, and we also tried to get some more understanding of the degree to which that has been implemented in the cities across Europe. And first of all, regarding policies, we see that approximately 50% of the cities we surveyed has a specific homelessness strategy in place. And a majority of these strategies are embedded in a regional or national strategy. At the same time, of course, this also tells you that 50% approximately of the cities do not have a specific strategy or policy in place to tackle and to fight homelessness. But of the cities that do, almost 20% has implemented housing first policy. And together, this has added up to around 1,678 people that have been housed in these cities in the, let's say, more or less last year before we conducted the survey. And also when we break it down per urban classification, we see that mostly the larger urban areas are implementing housing first. I should directly also make a note in this respect, because we saw in the survey that the smaller urban areas actually do not call it as such, but they do also follow this housing-led approach, although in a less formal way. Next slide, please. Yes, so I mentioned it already a bit before, but of course we cannot overlook the pandemic, and we also would like to see beyond. And so we did not only ask the cities about the trends in homelessness before the pandemic, but also what they have experienced now during the pandemic. And actually for now, oft cities indicate that their homelessness numbers are still stable. I'm saying still, or yet maybe they have not changed yet, because many of them also indicated that they expect these numbers actually to increase with a bit of time delay, especially when the numbers of evictions will add up, and also when all these support measures will stop. So it takes a bit of time. 28% already saw this increase indeed, and 7% actually saw a decrease in the numbers of homeless people, and most of them indicated that it was because homeless people were temporarily housed with family and friends during the pandemic. Overall, a trend that was noted is that the number of young women in shelters increased during the pandemic, and this is most likely related to an increase in domestic violence in the houses. So the increase in domestic violence. And the biggest challenges that were named that people experienced in the shelters was the inability to test, because many of the homeless people were not eligible, especially in the beginning, to undergo a test because they lacked the social registration numbers. And also the isolation of ill people was very challenging, not only suspected COVID cases, but also confirmed COVID cases. And we also asked the cities to what degree they think that the measures they have implemented during the pandemic are actually will be implemented long term, whether they will stay or not, and also how sustainable they are. And most of the cities did not reply super clearly to this, mostly stating we will implement them as long as they are needed, but not giving a real time frame or any sort of confirmative action that measures will take in place. Although some cities did mention that, for instance, they would like, multiple cities said they would like to keep this opening of 24 hours opening of reception facilities, also keeping in place more security and privacy distancing measures, the development of autonomous housing projects, the activation of single access and orientation centers in the city. And a lot of them, I think most, also mentioned strengthening this integrated integrated work with the health services to take that along as a lesson learned after the pandemic. But as far as the transition of buildings such as hotels towards housing for homelessness, cities were not really outspoken about that yet. Asked if they would plan also to include the issues of housing precariousness and homelessness in their pandemic recovery plan, 37% of the cities said they would do that. Next slide, please. And indeed, I said it before, we cannot see homelessness without looking into housing, affordable housing, accessible housing, and in that respect also social and public housing. And 38% of the cities stated that homeless people can indeed access social public housing in their city, and 69% also indicated that they have priority access routes for homelessness people in their cities. When we break it down again, per urban classification, we see that mostly the larger urban areas indicate that they make use of the public and social housing to house homelessness. But of course, we have to also be aware of the fact that it also depends a lot on the available stock of social and public housing to begin with in a city, but maybe also on the definition of how you define a homeless person. Next slide, please. And one issue I did not refer to yet regarding our study, but which is important, is homeless migrants. And I would like to refer to another forthcoming study of the JRC in this respect, which is a report on a place-based approach to migrant integration in functional urban areas. And based on a case study they performed in Liège in this respect, they identified three main challenges and issues with the migrant population under homelessness persons. First of all, they see that the lack of registration for migrants is really putting an additional barrier in order to receive help, because they are often the services are only available for those with a prolonged residence permit. And also, migration policy and policies for migrants, they often fall under a different legal domain. So they do not play by the same rules, so to say, as the native homeless population, which also creates an additional barrier, and not only for the homeless people themselves, but also for the people who would like to help. And then it was also observed that the EU funding that, of course, tries to support this kind of integration or integration of the migrant population, it's also quite rigid. So you have to really plan your projects much in advance, and there's no real space for maneuver, for instance, when you suddenly have to deal with a higher influx of migrants, which is often the case, that it's not really, it's not something that is planned in advance. So there's some kind of rigidness of the funds that also faces creates the third barrier they identified. Next slide, please. And three other reports that I would just quickly try to point out to you, also related to the inclusive and sustainable housing market, or a preferred inclusive sustainable housing market in Europe. First one is Who Owns the City, which actually studies the financialization of housing in EU cities, also relating it to affordability issues. A technical report from the JRC that really looks into the house price dynamics and affordability of house prices in Amsterdam. And there's also another forthcoming study next year, which looks into property investment and housing affordability in Lisbon and Porto. And actually what we see from this study is that especially the younger classes, the younger population in Lisbon and Porto, has increasing difficulties to access the housing market, for which they have to stay with their families, they have to reside with their families for much longer than planned, which would actually also fall under one of the ethos-like typologies, staying with family and friends longer than you want. Next slide, please. Yes, because I came to the third section of my presentation, where I would just like to also elaborate a bit on some EU policies and initiatives that are currently in place. So yes, next slide. So first of all, I think it's good to stress that EU member states have the primary responsibility and also competence to address homelessness. Notwithstanding, the Commission really stimulates and tries to trigger this to cities to or member states to adopt a long-term housing-led integrated homelessness strategies at national, regional, and local level, and also to introduce efficient policies to prevent evictions. So, for instance, effective homelessness strategies may cover the prevention and early intervention of homelessness, quality homelessness service delivery, rapid rehousing, systematic data collection, monitoring, and using shared definitions, like we mentioned before. Next slide, please. And then in terms of, I will just highlight some of them in terms of policy and funding, mainly the EU structural and investment funds, especially for the next programming period, can be used on the ground in member states. So each member state will actually have to invest at least 25% of its European Social Fund plus ESF Fund plus funding resources in social inclusion. And thus they will be able to launch strategic political reforms to eliminate homelessness with this funding. But the EU, for instance, also funds research, transnational learning, and mutual exchange through, for example, the EU Programme for Employment and Social Innovation. For what regards children and youth, the fight against material deprivation, this was formerly the FEAD funds, will be also included under the ESF Plus, and it must represent at least 3% of the resources invested. So part of the fund is actually earmarked, especially for the fight against child poverty. And for those member states whose rate of children at risk of poverty or social inclusion is higher than the EU average for 2017-2019, they must spend at least 5% of their ESF Plus resources on promoting equitable access to children, to free healthcare, to decent housing, and to adequate nutrition. And since housing is not an island, we have to face this issue, housing, homelessness, we have to face this issue with taking into account many, many sectoral policies and also, of course, the building stock and living conditions. So building renovation and to kickstart recovery. Also, the Commission has its recovery plans tend to further support renovations for EU buildings and also by means of the renovation wave, but also the Next Generation EU and the next programming period, they also provide opportunities to improve energy efficiency and the quality of the building stock in Europe. Under the renovation wave is also the new European Bauhaus that also aims to foster innovative solutions to sustainable and accessible housing for all. Next slide, please. The European platform to combat homelessness, it was already mentioned before by the minister. So this is something that has been launched this summer by means of the Lisbon Declaration on the European Platform on Combating Homelessness. It's a platform that brings together European institutions, EU governments and civil society that have committed to working together towards combating homelessness in the EU. It's meant to trigger dialogue, to facilitate mutual learning, to improve evidence and monitoring, and also to strengthen cooperation. And it's a concrete deliverable of the European Pillar of Social Rights Action Plan. And all those who have signed, they have pledged to work together and they agreed on the following objectives. So no one sleeps rough for lack of accessible, safe and appropriate emergency accommodation. No one lives in emergency or transitional accommodation longer than is required for a successful move on to a permanent housing solution. No one is discharged from any institution, for instance, prison, hospital, care facility, without an offer for appropriate housing. Evictions should be prevented whenever possible, and no one is evicted without assistance for an appropriate housing solution. And finally, no one is discriminated due to their homelessness status. Hereby, I've come to the end of my presentation. I would like to thank everyone. I'm not sure if there are any questions in the chat and we still have time to address. I see my email address is actually not there, but I will share it in the chat afterwards. So also feel free, if you're more comfortable with that, to send me an email later with some specific questions. Thank you once again.
Yes, thank you very much, George, for this very interesting study. And I'm sure this is what I said in the introduction. This is really a topic that will remain so high on the agenda. I mean, I've been listening to the news, of course, like every day, but I think almost every day there is a news item on this particular topic. And this is not exclusively the case in our country, the Netherlands, but also in the other countries. Really interesting to have this overview and to have also, let's say, the full research capacity of the Joint Research Center involving in this field. There are a few questions. I also have one question, but let me first pick a question from Andrew Lombardi from the OECD, who really asked an interesting question, namely, to what extent is there any correlation between the social housing stock in cities and the amount of homelessness in those cities? Can you clarify that, perhaps?
Thank you, Mart. Also, yes, and thank you for the question. No, it's a very interesting question, and actually we are at the moment still trying to analyze this ourselves. This is also why I made the note when I presented the results that it does depend also on the housing stock that is actually the public and social housing stock that is available in cities, to what degree they actually use them in order to house homelessness. And then we want to correlate that also with the numbers of homelessness people in that city. I'm not having the numbers now to present to you already, but we will work with the assuming hypothesis that if actually cities use social and public housing to house homelessness, to homeless people, that it will also correlate with the fact that that there are less homeless people.
Yeah, perfect. Now, perhaps also to clarify a bit, there was also another remark in the chat I saw. I mean, what exactly is the difference? But can you explain this ethos light? I mean, you said it is a typology, it's not a statistic as such, right? So, but what's the relation between ethos light and the general ethos? Can we explain that perhaps? There's a bit of misunderstanding. That's what I noticed in the
chat. Okay. Well, maybe it's most often referred to the ethos light. So maybe just stick to the ethos light, because this is a definition typology that is the holy grail, so to say. So let's just stick to ethos light. I think it was designed in 1997 by Feanza. They made up this typology based, of course, on their on being very knowledgeable about all types of homelessness that can be encountered. And the relationship between this typology and statistics in itself, it's not a statistic, but it will help us. It serves statistical purposes, because if all cities, institutions, urban agglomerations would collect their data according to this ethos light definition typology that we have in place, we could harmonize data, we can compare data, we can say this city has like so much percent of mobile homes, people living in temporary structures, this city has so many people living out in the streets, this city has so many, so it will help us to get the full picture of all people that are considered homelessness according to this definition out there.
You emphasize according to this definition, right? And I think that's not irrelevant, because I remember sometimes there are some categories which fall outside those definitions. Some younger people perhaps, but also the elderly. I think over age 65 or so, are they counted within those definitions or not? Could you explain, are there any categories that fall outside the official statistics?
Well, okay, so the answer is twofold. Yes, there are many categories that fall outside the statistical definitions in almost every given city. But this is not because the ethos light typology does not, that's actually a very all-encompassing definition. I would say it's mostly the broadest one out there. It's really done a great job in trying to catch all homelessness or very much at risk of homelessness people out there. But of course, many cities do not use this all-encompassing definition. So that's where many of the statistics might go wrong.
I see. So in some national and probably also local statistics, I mean, there is a problem. It's not with this ethos light is, let's say, the right approach, but in practice, because this is what I read a lot. I mean, looking into this topic, that we lack data, we lack comparable data, and this is something, of course, that you at the EU level could also even further promote. And
yes, but
I hope that with this study it will help.
Indeed, indeed. And we try to follow the ethos typology. And we see that actually also the bigger cities adhere to it. But for instance, Vienna, they do use it. They have very good data. They do use the ethos typology, but they did make a minor adjustment because some of the categories did not fit how they collect data within the city. So you will, I'm not being, I know that in the end we will still face issues, but at least trying all to collect data according to this definition would already be a step forward.
Yes, indeed. Now, there was one big exception in your overview, and that's Finland, right? Yes. The only country where actually homelessness decreased. Apart from that, we see alarming messages, a rise of 300% over the past 10 years in homelessness in some countries, for instance. What about Finland? I mean, what's happening in Finland at the moment? Why there, is it too cold to be homeless, or what is the problem there? Or, I mean, what is the solution to the problem? Let me put it that way.
No, Finland. At one point, they switched from emergency accommodation, temporary accommodation. I think they had 600 emergency accommodation beds to the housing first policy. So they actually created housing first options and policies in order to house all the homeless people directly in this supported housing service. So and I think they went from 600 to 80. Beds that are now used for emergency accommodation. So it's really the housing first policy that explains this drop in homelessness in Finland. I don't know if there's time, but I can note that also Finland, actually Helsinki, did mention that they also experienced some challenges now with the housing first. So they are really a prime example, but they also have some issues now themselves because they use this housing first service flats. They would like in the end that also the homeless person move up again or move on again from these flats, but they see that this is not happening in the degree they wished. So they also see some issues with that because they see there's now a bottleneck one step up. But still, no, Finland is clearly a very good example of the housing first policy and how it works.
Oké, dankjewel Soertje. Ik ga in het Nederlands zitten, omdat ik ook zie dat ik blijkbaar in de Nederlands categorie ben ingedeeld. Dat maakt het wat gemakkelijker voor de vertalers. Volgens mij gebruikte ik geen enkele vertaling, maar goed. Misschien is dit het moment om Soertje nog een keertje te bedanken. Hartelijk dank. Ik begrijp inderdaad dat je e-mailadres met ons zult delen. En zonder meer zullen we hierop terug blijven komen. Wat ik al zei, we gaan ook een rapport uitbrengen over dit webinar en daar zullen we ook uiteraard verwijzen en gebruik maken van de onderzoeksresultaten van het Joint Research Center. Ik wil graag nu overgaan naar de breakout rooms. En dit is een nieuw technisch hoogstandje, dus ik moet iedereen vragen even goed op te letten. We hebben drie breakout rooms. De eerste gaat over een onderwerp dat een aantal keren aan de orde is geweest, Housing First. Daar waren ook wat vragen over en ik wil iedereen die daar erg in geïnteresseerd in is ook uitnodigen om de verkorte URL die hier ook in beeld is gebracht en ook in de chat is gekopieerd, te volgen om naar de breakout room te gaan over Housing First. We hebben daar twee presentaties en telkens is het volgens hetzelfde schema. Eerst hebben we een presentatie van een buitenlandse gast. In dit geval is dat Marseille met Raphaël Bouloudin, vervolgd door een Belgisch voorbeeld. In dit geval Charleroi met Laurent Tchakia. De tweede breakout room gaat over collective housing, collectieve huisvesting, habitat collectief. Daar zien jullie ook hier de link voor de breakout room. Dat is dus een link die echt aangeklikt moet worden om daar naartoe te kunnen gaan. In de tweede hebben we twee presentaties, uiteraard ook weer. De eerste is een voorbeeld uit Utrecht, David de Goede, van de tussenvoorziening. Spreekt over ervaringen met collectieve huisvesting in Utrecht, in Nederland. En daarnaast hebben we een presentatie van Cadans Wonen uit Antwerpen met Yves Kempeneers. En de derde breakout gaat over jeugd. En daar hebben we ook weer twee voorbeelden. Eén. Uit Edinburgh, Gary Neal van Rock Trust. gaat zijn project presenteren, gevolgd door het voorbeeld uit Kortrijk, Back on Track met Wouter van Klooster. Dus ik geef iedereen nu de tijd om naar die verschillende breakout rooms te gaan. Nogmaals, klik de link aan, want het is een nieuwe Zoom-sessie die dan geopend gaat worden. Deze, de plenary, de algemene webinar, blijft open. Dus die kan open blijven, kunt u ook uiteraard naar terugkeren. Maar ga vooral nu naar de breakout rooms. En aan het einde keren we nog één keertje terug voor een definitieve afsluiting van dit webinar. Ik wens iedereen heel veel inspiratie en plezier ook bij de verschillende breakout rooms. Tot straks in de plenary.